Welcome to Relay.
Oh!
Is this? Ha! Hello!
Afraid.
Hello! Okay, everyone.
I'm afraid.
Yeah, hi, be afraid. Welcome. Welcome to the Beefcast. This is the cast where we cast some beef. It means we get angry, and when you get angry, you get hangry, and when you get hangry, you eat stuff, and then you probably throw that stuff up because you're so angry at the things that you're talking about. But we're not really going to get that angry anymore because we're not that kind of people. We've all mellowed out. We've gotten a little wiser and calmer in our old age. Specifically Shiver.
It's true, but you can't...
It's actually... not the worst intro for completely winging it. So, guys, seconds before we go live, David's like, oh, crap, I didn't write an intro. Guess I'm winging it, and we went live. So, yeah.
Yeah. Welcome to the Beefcast.
Yep.
This is the segment where we stop talking about Star Citizen because, hey, Star Citizen is not the only game out there. We do actually like other games. Still going to talk about Star Citizen and how some of these games play.
Yeah.
We're still going to bring it back to Star Citizen because, hey, that's who we are.
I don't think we can have a conversation without bringing up Star Citizen.
I sit at work.
Have you discovered Minesweeper? It's awesome.
I mean, there will be some aspects of Minesweeper in Star Citizen, of course, as we all know.
I would love to play Minesweeper while I'm in freaking quantum travel.
Yeah.
Just saying.
But that said, I need some help picking a beer. So while we continue blabbering for a little minute, someone tell me if I'm drinking a Pilsner or an IPA.
IPA on the last one.
Well, I'm going to have both. Yeah, that's which true. Do I start with?
Start with Pilsner.
Okay, I'm going to start with a Switchback Pils.
Yep.
There we go. Now, Hell's Havoc XXX, we are not going to discuss today's live stream because none of us have had time to see it yet.
For that.
And we haven't had time to look at it yet because we have jobs and literally just got home from those jobs to turn this on. That said, we are going to start with WWP or what we playin. And we're going to talk a little bit about the Switch, talk a little bit about Zelda, talk a little bit about Mass Effect Andromeda, then we're going to cover some DLC, and then we're going to be done, say goodbye, and I'll go die. So, let's switch over to Show and Tell. And, hey, Jake.
Oh, am I going first?
We're
going
to start... Is that how this works? Sorry, I'm choking a little. We're going to start with you. What you been playing?
Okay, so, this is probably going to go against everything that that everyone in Relay's audience stands for, but this game that I played is called Horizon Zero Dawn, and it is a PlayStation exclusive game. God. Yep. Deal with it. Deal with it. It was made by Guerrilla Games, who are most famous for the Killzone franchise. And this game is nothing like Killzone.
Good. It was bad.
I mean, the first two were pretty good. The third one was all right, and the last one's just bad. So this game literally ticked every single box that could that is deep in my heart, my soul, and makes me happy about video games. So it takes place in the distant future. So mankind progressed to no. So mankind progressed to like a futuristic like that type setting, and then everything went bad, everything shut down, and then thousands of years later, everything gets overgrown, and then people lived as kind of tribal things again. But what's interesting is that roaming the land are these giant mechanical animals. We're talking like dinosaur things, giraffe looking things. You'll see in a second. I'm looking at the stream is going to be delayed slightly, so I apologize if it's weird, but it plays it's got like the mechanics of like Tomb Raider with, because it's mostly use your a bow. It's got a little bit of Mass Effect in it. It's a completely open world game. You have dialogue choices. Dialogue choices don't really mean a whole lot, though. That's not the point of this game. You have some melee combat, but it's pretty basic. But there's collectibles. There's bandit camps. It's got a little bit of Far Cry in it. And it's awesome. So yeah, like you'll see it on the stream here now. Like, there's huge mechanical robot creatures that are, like,
Bielik
roaming
the
landscape.
Says that it's Ubisoft done right, and everything that I've seen about it does really feel like Far Craft Assassin's Creed-y to me.
Exactly. So what actually really surprised me is that, like, I really love this setting. It's a setting that is very unique and really hasn't been done before. I love all of the characters, but I was actually really surprised how excellent the writing is in this game. It has a lot of really good environmental storytelling. There's a lot of like audio logs and text logs that you find scattered around, and you find them from like from the ancient civilization past. And just it's phenomenal. The story is amazing, and like you get to a point in the story where like, okay, I see where the climax is, and I see where this is going, and then something happens completely opposite of what you think, and then the game keeps going for 8 more hours, and like there's still 8 more hours of intense story and epicness, and it completely impressive. But The best part of this game is the combat. I have never played a game with better combat in my life. So the cool part about this is, you'll see it on the screen here in a second. She's gonna, Aloy's gonna fight this Thunderjaw. It's a huge, giant robot dinosaur. You have a lot of different tools at your disposal, most important of which is you have something that lets you scan the creature and kind of check out where its weak spots are. What's really cool is that if you look very closely at this creature, it's got all these moving parts. It has all these panels and musculature and components just kind of strapped onto it, and you defeat it not just by shooting it, but you have to kind of like remove these components. You can take their weapons and use it against them. They have specific weaknesses depending on which creature it is. Like there's some creatures that have literally like tanks of like gasoline on their back, because that's their job, is to carry gasoline around, and you just shoot it and explodes and takes out everything around. And
are they on a petrol?
I think so. The cave people call it Blaze.
Of course.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's kind of really cool because they refer to like a lot of like old technology, but it's like very like advanced technology with very basic terms. Like they have a very basic language, and it's really, really good.
So it's good.
It's one of those things where it's like, I don't often recommend people buy a console for a specific game, but, and we're going to talk about another such game in a minute, but
yes, we are.
Horizon is definitely a game that everyone needs to play. If this game, I put probably about 60 to 70 hours into this game, and it's very dense, and everything about it is fun, and it's awesome.
Now, so Nakara,
check it out.
Nakara, Shiver, I know neither of you have played this. I haven't either. Any thoughts?
This is one of those. Yeah, I definitely have thoughts on it. This is one of those games that, like, I probably will buy a PS4, and a large part of the reason, or a PS4 Pro, a large part of the reason is that game. It's kind of an accumulation of things. There have been several games over the past like 5 or 6 years for the PlayStation platform that I absolutely would love to play, but you have to have PlayStation.
Yep.
I have a question there, actually.
Go ahead.
would you consider PlayStation Now, $15 a month streaming service that PS4 games are going to be coming to this year?
Absolutely, but as far as I'm aware to this point, it's only going to be old games.
PS4 coming.
But yes, I absolutely would consider that, but I don't want to wait like 4 years to play
it.
So we'll have to see.
And another thing that I can attest to, you always find that the performance on a console is kind of poop. This game runs at 1080 60 and it's one of the most beautiful, it's easily the most gorgeous game out there. Like, look at this.
Shiver, thoughts?
It's incredible.
I can see why it would appeal, but it does not appeal to me personally. I mean, I don't like
Shiver
Assassin's
only plays,
Creed or
Shiver
anything
only
like
plays
that.
4X
yeah.
games.
I do love 4X games. I do.
Did you play the new Tomb Raider games?
No, like I didn't even play the old Tomb Raider games. I didn't play the first Tomb Raider games where she had a triangle chest.
Those are old school.
I mean, you can play that,
and that
in
was
your browser
on the PC
now
as well. I think so.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure every Tomb Raider game is on Steam at this point.
I think the last platform or sort of game like that I played was Super Mario Brothers 3 on the Nintendo, and that fucking annoyed me.
So, Nakara and Shiver, I believe the next what we play in is you guys. You're kind of tag teaming this one.
Yeah, to an extent, I think because we've both been playing it.
I can't go with a video. I've just got the images that you guys sent.
That's fine. I just thought I would send it to you.
Yeah, next time I'll do that. I'm dumb.
But no, we're playing Stellaris Utopia. So this month, a gigantic expansion came out for Stellaris that touches almost every area of the game, including core mechanics. Really fills out the game. Kind of what Paradox did with this game in the beginning was they made a really, really good foundation for the game, and the DLCs have really fleshed out the rest of it. Specifically with Utopia, you can now build space habitats, you can build Dyson spheres, which is so cool. So when you build a Dyson sphere, it takes an enormous amount of time and resources. And for those who don't know what a Dyson sphere is, it's a concept in science fiction. You actually build a sphere around a star to harness the energy of that star. So you can build Dyson spheres, which is really cool. And when you build the Dyson sphere around the star, all the planets freeze and die that are around it. You can build habitats, so basically large inhabitable space stations. You can build massive sensor arrays, so you can actually see the entire galaxy, everything happening in the entire galaxy. And you can also build massive science stations. These are all called megastructures. Stellaris is an incredible game. It's for the 4X fans or strategy fans out there. It is it's very deep and getting deeper all the time. Paradox is a great developer.
I'm not smart.
As well as being accessible. It's pretty accessible.
It is. No, it totally is.
I'm looking at those screens and thinking, what?
Well, I'll put it this way. I play this game with my 12-year-old niece, and she loves it.
I am dumber than a 12-year-old. I will admit that freely.
Same.
Sure.
But it's really incredible. There's a whole bunch more stuff with it too. There's ascension perks and traditions that you can customize your race. A new hive mind thing, so you can basically be the Borg. It's really cool. Anyway, Shiver.
It's a bit different to a lot of 4X games in there is a story that if you read it, it's quite an actually interesting story rather than just an excuse to build a sprawling empire and then defend it. And the main objective lore-wise for your race can be discovered quite early on, so then it just becomes more of a sandbox traditional empire building game, but it's really good, and the addition of Steam Workshop things to it is flipping awesome.
Acid says that's a really nice skin for Excel.
Thanks, Acid. My best friend.
Yeah, I mean, having played
Eve fits that description much, much better than Stellaris does.
I remember Austin Walker from Waypoint was like raving about this game when it came out, and it looks cool, but
it looks
much
like
Shiver
great 4X, said about Horizon, but I can't not play them.
I it's a really, really good 4X game, but it does veer more towards the grand strategy side as well, because if you keep in mind where Paradox came from, they are the grand strategy company. Yeah. They make Europa Universalis, Victoria, they make Hearts of Iron, they make Crusader Kings. These guys like rule grand strategy, and this was kind of a step outside for them. Also, huge, huge props for the work that they did with the graphics engine. This is the same graphics engine as games like Europa Universalis, which is like a 2D flat map of Europe. Like, you know, so it's called the Clausewitz engine. They did a really cool job with it. But it's a really good game. I gotta share something with you, a recent gameplay story of mine. So they added a ton of events with the Utopia expansion. And recently, I was playing a game, and I sent an explorer to explore and survey a black hole. He was contacted by something called the Worm and disappeared.
Oh!
Promptly thereafter, we sent another explorer to go and see what happened to him, and he was also contacted by the Worm and disappeared. Nice. We sent a third explorer with the full knowledge that he would die to see what happened to him, and he also vanished, but we got a little bit more data back, and then everything was kind of quiet for a while, and then one of my admirals, right, that commands one of my fleets, a duplicate of him popped up that was older. And so it's like the exact same guy, but like 20 or 30 years older. And he was muttering about like messengers and so on and so forth, about being able to travel back and forth through time.
Did he find that rift in space from Star Trek Generations where everything is wonderful?
That's an interesting thought. That's an interesting thought.
Yeah, the Nexus.
The Nexus, yeah. But the sort of long and short of this is that we start studying the messengers and so on and so forth. We found out that they've been genetically changed, and we decide to spread these, or actually, the researchers independently decide that they should spread these genetic changes throughout the race. And all of a sudden, my entire race becomes a different race genetically, and it changes like your core traits.
That's
it was really
awesome.
Interesting.
A little bit of Nexus, a little bit of Khan.
I have and, to ask, have either of you played Twilight Imperium?
Yes, I have.
Is this Twilight Imperium the video game?
Kind of, pretty close. I mean, they're definitely in the same area, right?
Okay.
I would definitely say that they're related.
They've missed out on a couple of the tricks, I think, just graphics wise. They've changed the way that the food mechanic works in this latest update. As most 4X players would expect, food is now a shared resource that you pull into and is just shared. At the very least, just for immersion reasons, have completely non-entities just traveling around that look like food trucks, but they don't. There's galactic civilizations. 2 did it, and I think 3 does it too. And that's a turn-based game, but if you zoom in on your trade lanes, you actually see moving traffic in between, which is, you know, kind of immersive, and I like the touches like that.
The trade carts that go, and you can watch the trade carts. Mm. Yeah.
The okay. That's one of those things, right? Like, the developers have been putting in so much work this game.
Oh, we lost you there, Eric.
We lost you.
He's lost for words.
Sorry about that. I accidentally hit my hotkey for muting.
It's all good.
But what I was just going to say is the developers are really good, and they actually have mentioned Shiver just mentioned as like one of those we would love to implement it, but it's not at the top of our list things.
Right.
But even then, like the 1.6 patch that's coming up, that's sort of a quality of life patch. They're including a whole bunch of stuff that are like things people have wanted for since the game came out, which is pretty cool.
Cool.
But also, this is the most successful game yet for Paradox. 4X is a pretty small genre, and they've sold over 1 million copies of Stellaris. So that's pretty big.
Good for that.
Yeah. Anyway, I'll stop blathering.
Okay. I guess we move on to me. Yay, me. I've been playing a little bit.
Are you Mario?
Ooh, a frying pan.
It's game over. Mario.
No. For everybody.
Mario.
I'm disappointed in you.
That's all problems.
Mario!
I'm gonna have to go with the sickle, I think.
Anyway. I have been playing entirely too much.
Although,
like
from what I heard,
the rest of the internet.
Blunt objects are better than the zombie puppets because they don't get stuck in the zombie.
Player unknown.
Some of the light bounces off after you bash them. Hello, my friend.
I've also been playing a lot of PUBG.
Hey, man.
Hey, what's up? You got a gun, yeah?
I hate this game because of how perfect it is.
That's my teammate.
Oh, there's audio.
It's wonderful.
I forgot that. Sorry. Forgot that there's.
Mute the source!
I did! I muted it! I'm not good at doing the video thing yet. Just give me time and I'm fine.
Have any of you seen the movie or read the book
Battle Royale?
No?
What the hell is wrong with you both?
Alright, fine. Have either of you seen the movie or
Tron.
Or read the book?
No, don't say it. Don't say it. Don't say it. Don't say
it. It's the closest analogy.
Don't say it.
It's the closest analogy.
No, because it's terrible and should be burnt.
It's a bad version of Battle Royale. Have any of you seen the Hunger Games or read the book?
Yes.
Are you familiar with it?
Yes.
Are you familiar with the concept?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
This is
better.
It's
that.
So, you and 100 other people,
literally
100 people, you and 100 other people are in a airplane flying over an island, and you all jump out. And you all parachute wherever the hell on the island you want, and then you have to survive and be not dead.
Yes. There's guns and loot and things in all the houses.
You drop with nothing.
Towns.
Yep. Damn it, Jake, this is my game.
You know what? I also played this game.
Yeah, I know. it's just... There's something so perfect about it and so much more almost meaningful than most other, like, FPSs that are out there right now. Like, Battlefield, you run around and you feel so... Oh, I got nade spammed. Oh, I guess I better spawn again and nade spam. And oh, I died. I spawned again. This, you die. That's it. You're out of that game. And you go to another game. Like, but it's also not prohibitive. It's not like you die and then you have to wait 20 minutes for a new round. You die, you quit, and find a new one. Acid asks, what happens if you die straight away? You just quit the match and join a new match.
Game's done.
Game's done.
Yeah. You don't even have to. Is this a game for the millennials? You know, you're all getting so flippin' lazy, you can't even rage quit yourselves now. It does it for you.
No,
screw you, you get a fun new server.
Stay and watch if you really want to.
Actually, that's really fun in multiplayer, where you've got, like, four people.
Oh, that's
the
best.
And one of you dies, and then you spectate the other, and you catcall them, and it's great. It's great fun. It's amazingly fun single player. It's amazingly fun multiplayer. It's still early access, and the developers have...
And by single player, he means queuing by yourself.
Yeah, solo. It's multiplayer only.
You still match with 100 other people.
Yeah.
But you can play by yourself, you can play in pairs, or you can play in teams of four.
What's your average length of life as a player?
If you win, it's like an hour to finish the match, maybe?
I think it's 45 minutes to an hour.
Yeah.
Okay.
If you die,
I have a question for both of you.
Yeah.
So you both love this game, right?
Yes,
it's awesome.
Tell me why the score on Steam is 72%.
Probably, honestly, a lot of people probably don't get it.
It's also buggy because it's an alpha.
It's an alpha. It's still buggy as hell. It's still got a long way to go, but it is getting lots of support, and it's made a shit ton of money. But you probably like this is
they've sold a million copies.
Yeah, this is a game. One, as Acid says, it is an Arma mod, and then it was a KH1Z1 mod. It's basically the player unknown came up with this game mode idea, and then sold the rights to it to H1Z1, and then used the money from that to make this.
He's also made really successful Arma mods as well. If you are in that scene of the survival simmy like games, you would know who Player Unknown is. He's very prominent. He's one of the best modders out there. And
I figure there are two things.
Hang on. You would know who Player Unknown is.
Yes.
Yes.
I figure there's two things that lead to the bad negative reviews. One is people who just suck. The game is a lot more tactical than most.
I mean, no.
Well, the game is a lot more...
I disagree with that.
Lots of people drop in a city and die instantly and probably get pretty pissed. And then they do it again. Like, you gotta learn to, you know, find, like branch out. But then there's also trolls. Yeah. I mean, lots of negative reviewing is probably people trolling because they...
All the negative... I'm scrolling through them now. All of the negative reviews are for optimization reasons. And it's an alpha game.
It's so alpha, yeah. They've
already patched it three times since it came out, which is like 2 weeks ago. So
it's got a lot of little details that I love. Like if you pick up a frying pan and use it, like you can hold two main weapons, a pistol and a melee weapon, right? And you've got scythes, and machetes, and a frying pan. But the frying pan sits on your ass, and is actually body armor for your left ass cheek.
Yep. Also, now in this most recent patch, you can freaking lightsaber bullets with the pan.
Oh, really?
Yes.
That's amazing.
If you swing wildly, there is a chance you might survive.
It's
only the pan. Like, it doesn't work with any other melee weapon.
This is something like this is a game I've wanted for a long time. I don't like in Battlefield games, I really don't like the like TDM, die, respawn, die, conquest, die, respawn, attack thing, die, respawn, attack thing. I like rush. I like hardcore modes. I like consequences and having to be good. And
so
this game, you gotta be good.
I don't think we mentioned this.
Yeah.
One of the most important things about this game that kind of makes it stand out from other games, like H1Z1 or DayZ, is that in those games, like, the server just kind of exists, and you spawn in, and you're just kind of there, and, like the progression is, like, there not the progression, but, like, the goal is just to survive and not die, and
I found it really annoying in DayZ when I got all the best equipment and was still alive and was like, okay, what do I do now?
So the biggest thing about
this game... Eat the zombies.
The biggest thing about this game that makes me really like it is, one, you don't respawn, obviously. When you're done, you're done. It's a match made game. It's not a server. But two, in order to encourage, and by encourage, I mean force conflict.
Yeah.
Radiation starts seeping in from the edges.
You can actually see it on the map, on the screen right now. There's that circle. You have to be in that circle, and that circle will constrict constantly.
If you find yourself outside the blue circle at any point, you will begin to die slowly. So it kind of forces conflict, and it forces very tense situations.
Yeah.
Because, like, people will camp out in buildings, and then all of a sudden, like, they see the map is starting to constrict and go past the building. So it forces them to move out of the safe location that they're at, and then it will usually start a fight or anything like that. And it's extremely compelling.
And when you land, you've got like 10 minutes before it matters. And then you've got like 5 minutes. And then you've got 3 minutes. And then 2 minutes. And by 1 minute, you're in this little tiny area the size of like a building. And nobody wants to run into it because someone's watching. It's really nice because it starts out nice and easy, right? You like pick a landing spot. Oh, let's land here. Oh, there's no one around. No. Let's grab stuff, and then it gets more and more tense.
There's no one around you.
It's easy if there's no. But like you drop somewhere where no one's around, and then it gets more and more tense as you get in, and it's just it's
excellent.
Yeah, it's just excellent, and the games don't take 3 hours like Arma. It's like an hour max, and that's if you win. And I love that when you win, really all it says is winner, winner, chicken dinner.
Yep.
That's it. Winner, winner, chicken dinner.
Also, the only, they have cosmetic items that you cannot purchase at this moment in time.
Yep.
I'm sure that's going to be a thing at some point.
You can't actually purchase them on the Steam Marketplace because they can be sold on the Steam Marketplace.
Oh, I didn't know that. That's actually
People are paying like $20 for a camo shirt. Like camo jacket goes for so much.
But you earn...
But they'll never see it.
That's the point.
But essentially, the better you do in the match, the more currency you'll earn to unlock cosmetics.
And that's it.
But other than that, there's no progression. There's no like unlocking of weapons because you literally drop with nothing.
Yep. Every
your
time.
Fists. Every time you start the game, you start with nothing.
Yeah. Nakara and Shiver, any thoughts?
This is a game I would like to play. I haven't played it yet. It is on my Steam wish list. I took a break a bit for early access, so like last year, because I bought a bunch of games that I was just like, you know, a lot of early access games are
impression, and then you never touch them again.
Yeah, a lot of early access games are what you know they're not done.
Yeah,
big shocker, right? So I stopped buying. What I did for a lot of games is I started following them instead of buying them, and I'll watch to see if they ever get finished.
Yeah.
But this is one I would like to pick up, especially if I have friends to play with. And it looks really interesting. And I love that. I love the idea. I love the idea of the 500 people, or the, not 500, 100. The 100 people just like, you know, parachuting down onto the island, and then it's just like total pandemonium.
Yeah. I've got to say, the devs actually been supporting it really well. There have been a number of patches. There are planned like hard-coded modes where it's first person only, so you can't screen to me this feels like an early access that is still getting frequent updates, which means all the difference to me. Sorry.
I was just going to say, I also really like the idea in terms of gameplay design to have the shrinking play area. Because it does give you it allows quick repetition in the game, and so you don't get stuck into a really crappy game or something like that. Because you may never want to quit a game if you because you don't want to like die.
Yeah.
But yeah. It makes quick repetition. So one of the things I think makes Rocket League so successful is that it's 5 minutes. What's 5 minutes, right? You go jump into a game, it's 5 minutes, and you're done. Same thing with this. You know, someone might go play Arma for 3 hours or 9 hours, however long it takes. This is, whatever. Even if you win this, it's like 45 to 60 minutes, so that's a lot better.
Yep. Shiver, any thoughts?
Just, again, not my personal thing. I mean, I need, like, very few FPS in my life. Have you heard of this game called Star Citizen? That's going to have FPS in it. You see, that's pretty much probably going to fulfill my needs. Don't you dare. Don't you say it. You bastard.
I would actually really like to see something like this done in Star Citizen, to be honest.
There's nothing stopping players from setting that up. That's the beauty of Star Citizen.
It's just fun.
Oh, that's such a great idea.
It's just,
somebody's
got
to do that.
Like, it's
basically
just so
just
much
like
fun.
Litter a planet with players and be like, no one gets a
and
shit.
Then, right?
Go.
And then slowly bombard the planet and they have to, oh, that'd be, man, CIG?
Slowly bombard the planet.
Yeah. It slowly gets...
Actually,
do you know how many planets died to bring us the Hunger Games this
okay,
year?
All you do is you sign up test, you get everyone from test around a little moon, and you say, okay, test, after
wait,
10
wait,
minutes...
Wait, I've got to show my moon to what?
Me.
Oh, okay.
After 10 minutes, you're bombarding the entire left hemisphere of this planet.
Oh, God.
So, what I...
Tell me they wouldn't do that.
Can I?
They just drive into it.
Well, yeah.
Can I mention an idea I just had?
Go.
I think I'm sorry, folks. I know we're not. This isn't Star Citizen podcast.
Starcraft. We are a Star Citizen site. We will damn well talk about Star Citizen all we damn well please.
I was just thinking this would be such a cool idea. What if they created like a natural hazard around a world where if you came within like a certain distance, you crashed. Period. There's no way out of it. You crashed. And so it, like, just sucks in players. And just more and more people crash. And you end up having to, like, fight each other on the surface.
I'd love that. Honestly,
that would be so cool.
It would. Okay. So that ends it for what we play in.
Speaking of...
Oh, wait. I've got one more.
Yeah, we are done.
One more.
Okay, go, sure.
One more. Did anyone ever play, because you're all fairly old, did you ever play Transport Tycoon?
Yes. Yeah, I think
yeah?
So.
Yeah?
Yes.
If you like Transport Tycoon, check out Transport Fever on Steam. It's like the 21st century version of Transport Tycoon.
Awesome.
I'll end it there.
I love Tycoon games.
Okay, so we are done what we played. Check it out. I'm going to un-outline and unshadow that. And I'm going to outline and shadow our next topic. Whew, that was a long what we played. We've only got like 3 images for this, but I don't care because it's the Switch. Jake and I own Switches. Nakara and Shiro do not. Let's talk a little bit about the Switch.
Should I get mine to show the class?
Do it. Go.
Okay.
So, the Switch is the Nintendo, you've probably heard about it, it's fairly big deal nowadays. It's Nintendo's latest console, it's a handheld that plugs into an HDMI port that goes onto a big screen. It can be played, you know, like a standard console on a screen, or it can be played in your hands, like a Game Boy or 3DS or whatever.
You mean I have to use my hands?
Sadly,
that's like a baby's toy.
Yeah, I know. It's kind of bad, but I mean, you could use your feet if you really want. I don't know. The Switch is one of the biggest things that have come out in the past month. And on this show, we're going to be talking about, you know, things in the recent month or so. And to me, I think the Switch is possibly the best console that has ever come out. It still needs the games. Right now, its games library is kind of shit, except that it has one of the best games ever made, but that's also available on the Wii U. But it's the promise...
Skyrim?
No. The Switch, the promise of the Switch is just... I love being able to sit there and play it on a TV and then be like, no, I want to go lie down in bed and get up and take it to bed and lie down in bed and play Zelda before going to bed. Like, it's the portability of the thing, honestly, is fucking phenomenal. It has actually changed how I play games.
So,
go, Jake.
So it's about yay big. It's the screen is bigger than the Wii U's. But the overall, this is smaller than the Wii U tablet, which is really nice. What I really like about it is how thin it is.
It's like a really thin Game Gear.
Oh, God, the Game Gear.
Just for comparison, guys, this is the Wii U one.
Yeah. Turn yours sideways so that they can see the thickness of it, Eric. Yeah. It's the thing is, it's basically the Wii U gamepad. Now, the Wii U gamepad needed to be like 20 feet within 20 feet of the actual console itself, whereas the Switch is 100% portable. It's
so. The speculation was that there was going to be like some kind of processing unit in the dock. The dock is literally a USB-C to HDMI.
It does absolutely nothing. The dock does nothing.
The system is this.
Yep.
This is the Switch.
And that is, honestly, I think that's incredibly impressive. They're going to be able to fit Skyrim on there. It's going to support UE4. Zelda is one of the most beautiful games I've ever played in my entire life.
So another really great thing, if it'll focus, is that the screen is really bright.
Yep.
And it's also 720p, which is fantastic and unprecedented by a handheld console.
Yeah.
Also, here, I will also demonstrate this. So this just literally slides right off. Yep. There's a release button on the back right here that lets it come right off. And then it automatically syncs with your system as you remove it. What's really cool too is that there's shoulder buttons right here and right here. So you still have shoulder buttons even on these little tiny controllers. These can also slide into a separate controller piece as well, and also they sell
various things.
This,
yeah,
which is just normal gamepad.
Is that a Mega Drive pad? Genesis pad, sorry.
My thoughts on the Switch right now are, and we don't have too much to talk about the Switch because it's a console. Yep. But if it gets more games like Zelda, if Mario is as good as I hope it will be and as good as every Mario has been,
it will always be good.
But like Zelda, Mario, if Nintendo first party games alone are as good as Nintendo first party games always are, I honestly think that this will be one of the best consoles ever made because of its portability.
Did you ever play Splatoon, David?
I couldn't get into it. I hated the controls.
All right, so there's going to be not motion controls on this one.
Yeah,
so
which
Splatoon
I like.
Splatoon 2 comes out in the summer,
yeah,
which is a third-person shooter from Nintendo,
yeah,
which is kind of awesome.
Yeah, but not just
I have possibly a bizarre question, but is it a one-person-only console?
No.
Can you have your friends come and play on the same?
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Switch is you.
Yes, you can play on this little tiny screen or on
carry it, Jake,
on the TV.
Okay.
My favorite thing about this, though, and it's something Nintendo has resisted for a very, very long time, is as I mentioned before, power as well as its video comes out of USB-C. So you can charge it with any USB-C. Connection provided it has high enough voltage, which also means if you have a high enough voltage battery bank, it will also work with that as well.
That's actually really cool because you can just get a massive battery bank and hook it
up. Which I have, and it made PAX East very pleasant.
I bet.
But they're basically what Nintendo did with this is they kind of ditched their proprietary hardware for the most part, which is really, really nice.
Here's what the Switch is to me. You know when tablets first started coming out and there was all this promise of tablet gaming and it was a really big promise and then there wasn't a single game because they're all, like, it was all just upscaled Android games. It was shit.
I can name one, like, the number of really good
tablet games,
like mobile OS games on one hand.
Yeah. and you always wanted the promise of tablet gaming, but it never came true. There was never this portable actual games. It always just stuck around being, oh, I could play this on my phone, but I guess I've got a tablet and it's bigger? Question mark. This is, oh, I've got an Xbox 360 game in my hand.
Yeah.
It's not... It's a 3DS game, and it's severely hardware handicapped.
They're porting Skyrim to this.
I'm going to have Skyrim in my hand that I can take on a three-hour flight, or I can take it on an eight-hour flight, and hey, I'll just bring along a battery pack with me. Or it's USB-C, so I can plug it into anywhere that there's US. It goes fucking anywhere, and it's fantastic for that.
I'm actually quite concerned about that because I already take my Wii U gamepad to the washroom with me.
The number I'm not afraid to
this
admit
makes
this.
It worse, man.
I'm not afraid
to bring
admit
this to
this.
Work.
The number of craps I've taken while playing Zelda. Just like I'm sitting there. Thing is, I'm sitting there exploring
Shiver's
the
having
world.
Issues.
I'm sitting there exploring the world and like, oh, I kind of go to the washroom. Get up. And you don't even look away. You just walk while you're playing.
You just keep going.
You're dead to me. Dead to me.
Beautiful, beautiful.
It's called couch gaming, porcelain throne gaming.
A couple more things.
The porcelain
really
throne is more comfortable than most couches. So,
A couple more really awesome things about it is one, the games are very easy to carry around because they are this big.
And
they
come
not
in.
An
they
SD
come
card.
In.
They're about the size.
And they come in a case larger than this beer can.
Always the way.
It's true. What's really nice about it, and Nintendo has been really good about this ever since the DS came out, but. Like, I look at you, PSP, with your proprietary memory sticks that it cost $1 billion. Like, they were always really expensive to expand the memory. This just has a micro SD slot right here.
Yep.
So you can just expand it that
they've
way.
They've gone portable, less proprietary, and we're going to move on to the next topic, which also does quite a bit tie into the Switch.
And then one more thing I wanted to mention real quick. Kind of a cool thing to play multiplayer is you have the two sides of the game of the Switch, but these are also two controllers. So
yeah. Look at I like Shiver's
Shiver's like,
I'm just sat here, I'm like, I remember playing fucking Asteroids on this cardboard wooden thing, an Atari 2600, and now you've got like these two controls attached to a screen.
They just slide on rails and they click, and the build quality on this thing is like the best. It feels solid, like it doesn't feel like a flimsy piece of plastic. Like they used every inch of this thing to put hardware into it. And it's awesome. It's powered by NVIDIA's new Tegra chips, which is really cool.
So I gotta say, I think I grew up in the wrong time. I would love to have sat at school at lunchtime with the Switch and my friends like gathered around.
I agree. I mean, I just played Pokemon on my Game Boy Pocket. So, yeah,
that's the Switch.
That's the Switch.
One of the other amazing things about the Switch is actually one of the games that comes with it. You know what?
Bring the cat back.
No, the cat's gone. The cat doesn't like
me. I was going to load it, but it's updating. So.
Oh. Nikara, do you want to talk about Zelda a little bit? And then, because Jake and I have been talking a lot, so why don't you start by talking about it and tell Shiver exactly what it is, because Shiver thinks that Zelda is a top-down 2D...
I mean, on main consoles, it hasn't been that since
1998. True. So, Breath of the Wild... the funny story is that I actually bought my Wii U for Breath of the Wild, which is supposed to come out like a few months after I bought my Wii U, which was like 2.5 years ago.
2015.
And so after about 2 years of delays, it came out. But I always kind of felt like it would be worth it in the end. And so I held on to my Wii U. I didn't use it a lot for a long time. I've used my Wii U more in the last month or over 2 months than I did in the entire 2 years before that. I actually considered getting a Switch, but then I was like, well, then what was the point of getting a Wii U? I might as well just play Zelda on the Wii U.
I mean, did you play Bayonetta 2?
I did not. I should have.
You should play Bayonetta 2.
I'm actually really excited. Bayonetta, the first one, is on Steam now.
Have you never played the original Bayonetta?
No. I played a little bit of it, but not through it. Zelda Breath of the Wild, where do you start? Basically they took an incredible
why is he asthmatic?
What?
I hate Breath of the
Wild.
Oh god. Zelda games are almost universally fantastic games. They basically took that concept.
They're universally fantastic, but the last two entries were subpar.
Did you forget about A Link Between Worlds? Because that game is one of the best Zelda games ever made.
The last two main ones.
I don't know, man. That game is A Link to the Past Part 2.
Fine.
That makes it a main series game for me.
The last two main series were Twilight Princess and Skyward Sword, and they were both subpar, especially considering Wind Waker came before them.
I think it's a crime not to put A Link Between Worlds in that list. It's an utter crime. It's one of the greatest games ever made, that game.
So, anyway, basically, for the uninitiated, it is Zelda in an open world. And not a crappy, thrown-together No Man's Sky open world. This is
not even an Ocarina of Time open world.
No, which was quite limited. It is enormous. Absolutely enormous. And everything, I mean, this line has been said a million times, but everything you can see, you can go to. Which makes it really interesting, because you're like, oh, that thing looks weird over there. Let's go check it out. That's basically most of my experience with Zelda. What's that? I better go look. It's a really incredible game. My most impressive bits are the gameplay is like, the details are so well done. The gameplay is highly refined. They added a lot of really detailed features, like cutting down trees and grass and being able to affect your environment. Really complicated and varied ways to solve one problem. And also puzzles scattered over the entire world. One of the things they do the best of any open world game I've played is to make it not feel empty.
Yeah.
There is stuff everywhere. Everywhere you look, there are things to do, to collect, to solve, to explore. And there's a few comics to this effect on the internet, but it's really the amount of freedom is really cool, and you totally end up going places you're not supposed to go. Like,
yep.
You're at the beginning of the game, and you're like, oh, I really shouldn't be here. that's a giant monster. Right after the beginning part of the game, they sort of just like set you free, and they're like, "Go and do," and I like wandered into an area where there was like the end of the game boss, and or not end of the game boss, but one of the high end bosses, and
I
was running for my life for like 25 minutes.
I accidentally finished the game.
You did.
I was like, you know what? I've explored lots of the world. I want to kind of explore this massive castle in the center of the world.
Because
there's Hyrule Castle in the center. I want to just explore it. But I'm not going to go in the front door or anything. I don't want to trigger any cutscenes. I'm just going to, you know, explore around the back.
That's not how this game works.
It's not
at all.
I explored the back of it and crawled around the back and stealthed my entire way through. Didn't attack a single thing. And I was like, oh, There's an open window in this back part, and I jumped in the open window and boss fight.
Why is it always castles in Nintendo games?
It's very specifically Zelda and Mario that have castles.
Yeah.
Castlevania?
Not Nintendo. That's Konami.
Jake.
But sorry, can I? So the other thing with this game is that they did an incredible amount of work on the physics. The physics are really impressive. Most of the things in the world you see are affected physically. If you're like, hey, the wind is blowing this direction and I have enemies down there and it's just the right way. If I cut down this tree, the log will roll down the hill and it will crush them. You know, like it's really impressive. Go ahead.
Hey, David, I don't know about you, but Nintendo pays me the big bucks. They give me all the money.
Funny thing is, I'm waiting for you to say what you will, and then I'm actually going to be bringing this back to Star Citizen.
I'm actually about to talk about
Star Citizen right now.
Are
GameStop
you?
Are currently doing a God deal on Nintendo DS, where if you buy one, you get $30 cash back. I've done the math.
And
if
also we all you lose your soul because it's GameStop, and fuck them.
I don't know. I just tried to quote a Rick and Morty episode where he said that.
Yeah,
I haven't watched it.
Oh, you have no taste. That's right. Yeah.
I like comedy, not
all right. So how I'm gonna bring this to talk about Star Citizen is the most truly impressive thing about Breath of the Wild is Nintendo spent a lot of time building all these really cool systems that just work in the game. Whether it be physics, whether it be certain gameplay elements, whether it be certain items or abilities that you have in the game. But not only did they spend a lot of time making those work, they spent a lot of time making sure all of them work together.
Yeah.
So I'm going to give a few examples of this, and it's kind of amazing. So I went up to this little camp of bad dudes, the Bokoblins, but I don't expect you to know what they are, Shiver.
just they're goblins normal, with bokoh normal, horns.
Normal.
I thought they were goblins from Scotland.
they're just normal bad monster type creature, you know? There's like a little camp of them. They have like a campfire. Some other stuff, and I had a bunch of fire arrows. I'm just like, I'm just gonna lay waste these guys with some fire arrows. And in doing so,
you started a fire?
Like, I murdered them. I lit the grass underneath them on fire, as well as the crates next to them, wooden crates. Normally, these wooden crates have loot in them. Like, it could be food, it could be items, could be money, it could be anything. The amazing thing was, the box burned and then, like, broke apart. And then inside, all of the food was cooked.
Yep. Because it touched fire. It's...
Well, you will never loot cooked food in Zelda. Because that's a big mechanic of the game, is cooking.
Yep.
Yep.
The mechanic just works in that if you light a box on fire, whatever's able to be burned inside of it gets burned.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The other really interesting thing is there's an area of the game that's really, really hot.
Yeah.
Like the outside environment is really hot. And you can actually cook your food by just throwing it on the ground.
You actually have to watch out. You kill an animal in there. It drops the food, and you've got about 3 seconds to get it before it cooks.
Yeah. You can also, if you hunt with fire or bomb arrows, yeah, it will cook the meat that they drop. Another thing is this is a system. They kind of show you how it works, but I discovered it by accident. So there's an ability called stasis in this game, which basically freezes all momentum of an object. So, like, say, like, there's these boulders rolling down this ramp, you stasis on the boulder and it'll stop and you can walk up the ramp, right? What I didn't realize at first is that it stops all momentum. So if I smack it a bunch with a giant
hammer,
like club or hammer or something, it'll store all of that momentum. And then when the effect wears off, that boulder just rockets into the atmosphere. Not only that, but if you can climb on that object that you've hit, you will go with it, allowing you to travel very vast distances very quickly.
Yep.
Incredible things like this. It just makes sense. There's like electric circuit puzzles, and if you drop a metal sword to complete the circuit, it solves the puzzle.
Yep.
You can just not use the items they buy.
And that works because if you're wearing metal equipment in a thunderstorm, you will get hit by lightning.
We'll get hit by lightning. Also, you can throw metal objects at enemies, and then they will get hit by lightning.
Yeah.
it's fantastic. Every single system in that game works together, and this is why, CIG, listen. You got all these really cool systems you're working on. Make them all work together like this. Because if that happens, the gameplay will just create itself.
Yep.
And that is, I mean, honestly, for the uninitiated, that is like the core underlying fundamental principle of Star Citizen.
Yes.
Is to create all of these underlying systems that just makes the rest of the game function without them having to specifically code every last scenario.
That's why the physics engine is as robust as it is.
Yeah. Are there cats in next game?
Yes.
Yeah.
Sold.
There's also bird people.
Bird people?
And yep. Fish people.
Yep. And so real, and you find and dogs and you can feed them this food is and they'll lead you to treasure.
Yep.
Oh, yeah. And yeah, haven't done that.
You can tame horses. You can, like, you can just tame
mooses.
Yes.
If there are bird people, can I get a character and name it Tammy and kill all the bird people?
I don't know if you
can kill them. You can't kill them. It doesn't let you kill NPCs.
The game for children.
Yes. So here's my verdict on Breath of the Wild and also where it really kind of tied back to other games and especially Star Citizen for me is... I've had this love-hate relationship with open-world games now. Lately, I really like the idea behind Assassin's Creed, and Assassin's Creed, the pirate one.
Black Flag. Fantastic.
Black Flag is actually one of my favorite games. Period. I think it is
really great.
Insanely well done.
It's the best.
Was that the one they did a sequel to in France? And yes. Called it White Flag.
No. That's a great joke, though. But no, they did do a sequel to it. They did a sequel to it, and it was in, like, East Coast Canada, which is great, even better to me. But Assassin's Creed games have sucked shit lately. It's actually why... Syndicate was okay. Which?
Syndicate was okay.
It was okay, but it's also why Ubisoft was like, okay, no, we're not going to release one every year. We're going to go back to the draw. We're going to... Yes. But what wasn't? Better than Unity.
Too. I hope that now after Assassin's Creed and COD, game companies actually get into their head. Every year
is bad idea.
Is unacceptable because it's going to be just garbage, and you oversaturate the market.
COD going back to World War II? Yes, please. Thank you. Finally, for fuck's sake, it's about fucking time. And
they should have done it.
Was really good.
Infinite Warfare is all right, but. Yeah,
they should have gone back to World War II 6 games ago.
Yeah,
but they didn't. So,
thing is, like, I love open world games. I get lost in them, and the feeling of getting lost in them is great. And I like Assassin's Creed and climbing the buildings and running around. And I really want to play Horizon Zero Dawn because it's an open world and you've got a bow. And I love the Far Cry games and all that. And honestly, that's something I've been looking forward to more and more as Star Citizen develops, because it was never designed or built in the original Kickstarter as an open world exploration game, and it's slowly becoming that. Only you've got an entire star, like, galaxy of stars
universe.
To explore,
yeah.
Rather than just one planet, and that just it tickles me in a nice way, in a way that I like to be tickled. But there was something... No, and this is my problem. This is something that I really, really hope that CIG at some point, someone there is like, hey, we should look at what Breath of the Wild did and learn from it. Because Breath of the Wild is far and above with no paraphrasing and no problem in me saying this. I have no issue. It is the best open world game ever made, and it's possibly one of the best games ever made, period. And
it is easily one of the best games ever made.
Ever. And just everything it does is done to perfection. Every single inch of the world has something new.
It rewards exploration, which is something open world games don't do.
Yeah, but there's that adage of people always want to see what's on the other side of the hill. And Zelda rewards you by you get to the other side of the hill, and there's always something on the other side of that hill. And
I'm always surprised if there isn't something like immediately obvious, like.
But then you look at it an area, and it's like, yeah. Oh, wait, that tree, yeah. There's something exactly. Special about that tree. Let's go. Oh, that tree has a this. Like, everything in this game is special. And everywhere there's a different touch. And it's clear that they worked on it for, what, like a decade, for frick's sake?
Yeah.
Like, they put so much into this game. And it feels better than, like, Assassin's Creed. We all know how Assassin's Creed works. You climb a tower, you see where everything is, and then you do whatever you choose to do there.
I think saying Zelda and Assassin's Creed in the same sentence is just sours me.
But it's the point.
There's
right?
better games to compare Zelda to.
But everyone understands Assassin's Creed Towers, right? And they've yeah. And to be honest, Assassin's Creed Towers have become a staple of the open world game. Those towers are in everything now.
Even Zelda Breath of the Wild.
Yes.
Yep.
But in Breath of the Wild, the towers, you go up a tower, and all it does is it unveils a completely empty map. You have to go and map everything you want to see. You have to look and see, oh, there's something there. I'd better go see.
I think one of my favorite things Zelda did was it has fast travel. Because, I mean, open world game would kind of be a little slightly mind-numbing if it didn't have fast travel.
Yeah.
You got to earn those fast travel points.
Yep. You got to get to them.
You have to solve small dungeons in order to unlock the fast travel
points. You actually don't. As soon as you find it, you unlock it. But
oh, really?
Yeah.
No.
I agree.
I don't think. Well, I mean, there's always a good motivation for solving the shrines, though.
Yeah.
Yes.
But there's a good motivation for everything in this game. There's no actually, I was reading a really good. I like the Vive, right? The Vive to me means a lot. It's got huge potential for where it can take gaming. But right now, lots of the experiences in it are really short. And a Rick and Morty Vive game recently came out.
Yep.
And there have been a lot of people that have been refunding it and complaining that it's like 3 hours long. And someone in the Vive Reddit was like, look, guys, no. Yes, it's only 3 hours long in time, but think about what you're doing. You are playing that entire 3 hours. You're doing something that entire 3 hours, where if you look at something like GTA or Assassin's Creed, they fill a lot of time by saying, hey, go from point A to point B.
Yeah.
And that is your gameplay. And is that really fun? Whereas Zelda, you're still going from point A to point B, but there's so much shit between there. You never get to fucking point B, do you?
I was just going to say, you never do. You never get... You're like, I'm going to go there. And then, like, 4 hours pass, and you're like, did I ever get there? No, I didn't.
I've still only done... Like, I have about 20, 25 hours in at this point. I've still only done the first major dungeon.
Yeah. My verdict is Zelda Breath of the Wild is the best game I've played to date.
I haven't finished it yet, but it's definitely in my top five already. And
so,
it probably will end up being
the best. This is the greatest compliment I could ever give a video game. When we talk about games, a lot of the time we we talk about it like, oh, like the story's really good, the combat's really satisfying. We always say like the blank of this game is blank.
Yeah.
When I talk about Zelda, I talk about the things that I've done in Zelda because those experiences are completely unique to me.
Yeah.
My first thing that I wanted to explain to you guys in Zelda was how I accidentally beat the boss.
Yeah.
There's only one other game that to me to date has had that much of a hit to me at the end with the boss, and that was Fable 2, where you could actually just sit there and listen to the boss monologue for eternity until one of your AI guys, like one of your group, not even you, just says fuck it and shoots the final boss and kills him for you because he's sick of listening to a monologue. And there's something more about this game. There's just Shiver, your turn to talk. We've taken over for too long. What are your thoughts on Zelda?
I'd give that a try. I would, I guess. I'm not gonna go buy a Switch just for that, though.
It's almost worth it. Like Jake said earlier, there's only
The Switch is a really awesome indie game machine.
Right now, yes.
I am tempted to buy a Switch, and purely because there's you tell me there's a Mario Kart coming for it. I'm literally shocked to learn.
Friday. Yep.
I'm literally shocked to learn that it's number 8 because I played number 1.
Mm-hmm. I played 1 too.
And Mario Kart 8 is probably top 2 or 3 Mario Kart games. It's one of the best.
So we're going to move on slightly though, because so far everything we've been talking about has been love. This is what we like.
Can I just say one thing before we move on? You're very right in that one of the best things that Breath of the Wild does is reward exploration. And I have been talking about this in Star Citizen for 4 years now. It is the most important thing they can possibly do in Star Citizen is to reward exploration, because 70% of their player base wants to explore. It's also one of the hardest things to do. It's one of the reasons that Zelda took forever and a half to be made.
Yep.
But at the end of the day, having the incredibly rich world is more important. Than anything else.
Yeah.
Anyway, go ahead.
All right. Give me a second here. I need to do a few things. I need to do this. I need to do this.
I'll be back in just a second.
Can we talk about DLC first?
DLC first. Okay. Yes. Give me a second.
Because I want to talk about Andromeda, and I'm gonna talk very openly about Andromeda. If people don't want to hear me talk about Andromeda and things in Andromeda, very specific things that might spoil things for them.
I need a 2-minute break, but we're going to start DLC. Shiver, I'm passing the buck to you, and I'm saying good luck. Start us off on DLC. Start the DLC conversation. Can you do that?
Wait a minute.
What?
I hate DLC.
Wait a minute. Shiver, did you play The Witcher 3?
Yes.
Did you enjoy it?
Yes.
You would really like Zelda.
Fuck The Witcher.
Really?
Yeah.
Fuck you. You don't like the Hornet.
It's just me and you now, Shiver.
All right. So DLC. I'm pretty much against DLC on principle of it's a tiny little cake slice of an expansion, and I would rather pay 20 quid, 15, 20 quid for a full-on expansion, get all this shitty little DLC and maybe a little campaign in one great big lump sum, rather than this pick and mix crap of like, oh, I want the bow for my character there, and I'll have that bit there. Because as a consumer, I'm paying like 2 quid a pop for this, so you could end up spending the theory that you could spend more money on individual items than you could if you just bought an expansion like you could back in old days, like Red Alert, the very first Red Alert. You had Counter-Strike,
and Aftermath, and each one of those was like a little miniature campaign, another little miniature campaign, and even a secret mission. And that was 15 quid. And that was units you could use not just in this campaign, but then units you can use in a multiplayer skirmish. And now these piddly little DLCs, for the most part, dominate the market. That's my rant. Screw DLC. Stop it.
I'm not as vehemently against DLC as Shiver is. However, I am in agreement that I'm a huge fan of expansions, and it's way better if you give me big, giant chunks of goodness way after a game comes out. That'll make me come back to your game. You bet your butt. The Witcher 3 is one of the best examples of this. They put out two giant expansions, and they were basically their own games in their own right, which is kind of awesome. I also think back to games like StarCraft and Warcraft that did like their own very large expansions that not only completely changed game mechanics, but they also added huge long campaigns to further the story of the game.
You know, Blizzard's expansions are famous. They really are. You look at something like StarCraft Brood War and even Warcraft, going way back to Warcraft 2 Tides of Darkness and then Warcraft 3 The Frozen Throne. Like, yeah. It's like these are iconic expansion packs, you know? Yeah. Like, it's amazing.
Maybe, you know, like Wing Commander.
Well, and people don't... It's kind of unfortunate that the name has changed. Like, the Witcher DLC shouldn't those really
were,
be...
That was more like an expansion.
Those were called expansions.
They were called expansions? Yeah. Good. Yes. Because they're...
All of the DLC for The Witcher was free. All the DLC was free for The Witcher. Which and then the expansion came after.
But that's... Yeah. Like, that to me is more the way it should be, right? Like, don't make me pay $5 for horse armor.
And, all right, so I love how horse armor is still brought up freaking 11 years later.
It has to be. It has to be.
But here's the thing. Like, that was back when DLC was brand new.
Yes. They didn't know what they were doing, and people they were learning.
People had no idea what they were doing. And
admittedly, their DLCs did get better.
Yes. In fact, the next DLC for Elder Scrolls IV Oblivion is excellent.
Yes.
Shivering Isles?
Yes.
Yeah. Shivering Isles is great.
Fantastic expansion. Fantastic expansion. It's
wonderful.
Yep.
Has my favorite character in that entire game in it.
Sheogorath.
Yeah. Sheogorath is amazing.
Yeah.
That's kind of the thing too, is that a lot of people have actually turned against DLC in recent years. Go on Steam and go to the variety map pack for Call of Duty 4 Remastered and look at those reviews.
One of the main culprits that do the DLC that I hate right now is Civ 6. Because they've gone from having the best expansions, where you would have several civs and all sorts of shit for like 12 quid, to buy one civilization and scenario for £5. No.
And Breevils, they had paid DLC, they are more expansions, and that's what we were talking about, is that is okay. Nibbles of game is not okay.
I have to call. I have to right now, because they do a really great job of it. I need to give a huge shout out to Paradox.
Yes,
their DLC is spectacular, and mostly because it adds enormous amounts of gameplay to their games. But on top of that, because they'll put out a DLC they're almost expansion packs. Almost all of the major ones are basically expansions, but they'll put it out, and it'll be fairly expensive, say like $20 Canadian or American. But when they put out their new one, they put all of the old ones on sale for 75% off.
Yeah.
So if you aren't actively playing that game at this particular moment, you can go and go, oh, I want to play this game again. What, under what DLCs have come up since the last time I played? And you go and you can pick up like three DLCs for like $6.
Yeah.
And they're huge, like huge additions to the game and make your gameplay experience completely different. They do a really good job. So yeah, now, another good one.
I know it's not DLC and it's not expansions. This to me is a really weird one, but I really, really like the way they're doing it is Total War Warhammer. Now
I'm unfamiliar.
And this, I think it's amazing. So Total War Warhammer came out. And it had five races. It had Bretonnia, Empire, Dwarves, Orcs, and Vampire Knights. And then they also added Chaos Warriors, right? So six total races, one map, great game. Absolutely bloody freaking love the game. Total War Warhammer 2 has been announced. It's coming out later this year. New map. New races, full price, so four or five new races, but if you own the first one, all of the original races are going to be playable, and the two maps will merge together, so you can play with both maps, and an ocean in between. And there's going to be a third one.
That's very strange.
Total War Warhammer 3 with more races and another map, and then if you own all three, it all ties together. It's very strange. It's
very weird.
Are they doing a 40k version?
No, I don't think so.
Ugh.
Not interested.
Second they announce that, I will. It is all up in me.
But that's like, it's not DLC. It's not an expansion, but it's using the previous game to bolster a new game, which, and don't get me wrong, Total War 1 is it a full game, and Total War Warhammer 2 is going to be a complete game on its own. The amount of effort and like customization they put into each of the races are entirely different, and that's great. They all play completely differently, right?
Yeah,
like completely differently.
That's awesome.
The elves basically have one city, and everything they branch out from that one city is nothing. The dwarves are like stick to the mountains only. The Bretonians have horses. Like they're all completely different, and they're just and the amount I like this idea of not just throwing away what you did in the previous game, but adding to it. And I know it's not an expansion, it's not DLC, but I think it fits the conversation of giving people enough for their money.
Yep. And
Hear or play of Sonic and Knuckles?
Yeah.
Yes.
Who did?
It was fucking weird, because I don't know if it was the same everywhere or not, but you could put in Sonic 3...
Yeah.
As a plug-in on top and play as Knuckles in Sonic 3. And that was, that at the time, certainly was absolutely radical, because you could interchange different cartridges as well and play some weird third-person version. But that was quite cool. It just reminded me of that.
I do want to quickly try and transition us for a second to something that Brivals mentioned in chat. How about Elite's DLC model?
I don't even want to talk about it.
Oh my god!
It's gonna make me upset.
Well, that's good, because the next section is gonna get you upset anyway. Go, Nakara. Go, Nakara.
Do not sell an expensive expansion pack when you can't even explain what is in it, and have admitted that it will not be done when it comes out. That is taking advantage of your players. And I'm sorry, I'm not going to pull any punches there. Frontier did a really good job with Planet Coaster, but Elite is a total disaster. Elite is a disaster, frankly, in my opinion. Simply because, not necessarily because of the game, although I don't find the game very enticing, but how much they exploit their players. That is, it is.
They
just
promised
like
them worlds, and then they ridiculous. Constantly reduce it and reduce it and reduce and say, "Oh, this isn't coming, but we'll do it someday." Hey, guys, whatever happened to fucking people being able to host their own servers?
Well, I mean, yeah, that's a big issue,
I know it's older, but it's like it. That to me, that is the first one that they did. And they haven't learned from it. They've continued that strategy all the way through of we can do whatever the hell we want because our players will buy whatever the hell we sell.
So the game's $80 when it comes out, right? And it's not done. And then they announced the first expansion pack. Guess how much it is? It's $80.
Yeah.
And guess what? They come out and say, we can't tell you what's going to be in it, except for some very basic details. And it will not be done when it comes out. And it's like, no.
What the hell am I paying for?
Yeah. And
that's like CIG right now saying, hey, do you guys want to buy the expansion pack to Squadron 42?
Yes. What?
For more than Squadron 42 or the same price.
Hey, do you guys want to play $60 for the expansion pack for Squadron 42?
Well, not only that, but and then we're going to release it right now and you only have one mission and we promise to give you the other 21 missions later.
Bullshit. Absolute bullshit.
And
the other problem planetary landing.
Yeah, that was the same expansion.
Planetary landing in Star Citizen is a free update.
It's not even a free update.
The entire galaxy.
It's just there.
And as I understand it, you could at first release you could only land on 3 or 4 planets.
I'm not sure, honestly.
It was there was only like a very small amount of preset planets that you could land on.
And you could only land on barren planets and moons and stuff. So you couldn't land on anything interesting. And the other thing that bothered me about the whole thing is that, you know, it's just... I don't want to go any further into this. But it's so much of like... Oh, right. That's what I was going to say. It's a theory of mine for a long time based on how the developer behaved that I believe that they ran out of money to make the game and they just had to release it. And then that became more evident when they suddenly quickly ported the game to consoles and then announced a DLC that they said wouldn't be done for an enormous price. Like, it's great you're running out of money, that's fine, but don't take it out on your players, in my opinion.
Okay, Jake, any last words on DLC before we move on, because we're getting heated?
Yes. So I think you have to look at DLC very differently if you're talking about a single player or a multiplayer game.
Yeah.
If you're talking about a single player game, the expansions is like the best way to do it. If you're talking about a multiplayer game, however, I would never... If I were a game developer, I would never sell something that expanded the content of my multiplayer game for money. Because what that does is completely fracture your online community into two parts, people who pay and people who don't.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
This is why Titanfall, the first one, failed miserably. And it's why Titanfall 2 is still going very strong. It's because they learned their lesson from that game, and every single update they have made to Titanfall 2 has been free. Yep. Whether you sell cosmetics, whether you charge up front for your game, that's up to you. Both are completely fine.
I hate the idea of something like Star Wars Battlefront. Oh, you want these additional maps to play with all the other people that have these maps? You have to buy the maps. No.
Yep.
The maps should be, like, just let me play the frickin' maps. If you want to even give them additional weapons that they can only get or something else, but let me continue playing with everyone else.
So here's how the community has reacted to that ever since. I mentioned earlier the map pack for Call of Duty 4 Remastered. It is $15, which is the same price that map pack was when they sold it the first time, when it was out as just Call of Duty 4. That whole, the economics from 10 years ago no longer exist because of the ability to update your game as frequently as you're able to. Which is why games like Titanfall are successful. It's why games like Overwatch are successful. It's why games like Dota 2 and League of Legends are successful. Well, especially like Dota 2 is the best example of that. They completely updated the game for free. Every single new hero that they develop is free. It's all free, and it keeps a game alive for much longer because everybody can play everything.
Mm-hmm.
And that's essentially how the community feels about paid content after the initial purchase. Is expansions are all well and good, and cosmetics or paying up front for a multiplayer game are all well and good, but if you do anything else, it's not really a good idea.
Yep. Okay.
Can I just mention one more thing?
Of course.
I'm going to give one final shout out here to Paradox. For anyone playing Stellaris, or I'm not sure if it applies to every Paradox game, but at least to Stellaris, in multiplayer, if one player, if the host has a DLC, everyone in the multiplayer game gets it.
Before StarCraft II's multiplayer was free, that's how they did it for StarCraft II.
I think Payday 2 does it, and so does Killing Floor 2. Yeah. Lots more games have.
Well, do not fragment your user base.
Yeah.
Super important.
That is an okay thing, but I think it's still a half step.
It's a half step, but it's a lot better than it used to be.
Depending on the game,
it's a fair compromise.
Yeah, yeah. If you have to compromise, that would be a good option.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's move to our final topic. Jake.
Yeah.
Can you take a few deep breaths for me?
Uh huh.
So, we're now in our final topic for the evening. We've got about 25 minutes to talk this over. This is going to include a lot of anger, frustration, probably some swearing. Viewer discretion is advised. Let's talk some Mass Effect Andromeda.
All right.
Hang on. Nakara and Shiver, have you, either of you played this?
Not yet.
Andromeda? No.
Can you tell me what you've heard? Like, what is your initial impression?
What I've heard is that they did a Dragon Age 2 again. BioWare has this really hot and cold reputation where they usually make really good RPGs and occasionally make terrible ones. And it's unfortunate, but basically they dropped the ball on facial animations and story. The writing isn't very good. They didn't do the details work that you saw with Breath of the Wild. Some of their work was good. The exploration planet stuff was good, but a lot of it had left a lot to be desired.
Shiver?
It's Mass Effect 3 again, with even less importance on the dialogue choices, mixed in with Dragon Age Inquisitions, big open maps, but they've essentially taken a lot of the deeper RP elements out of one of my favorite RPG series.
I would disagree with that.
I know you will. It's why I was letting them speak first.
Also, the screenshots that we're showing right now are not really indicative of actual problems with this game.
They're not. They're just random screenshots.
The 2010 to 2016... comparison. The 2016 animation in the second one is the pre-rendered trailer that they showed when they revealed the game, which actually had really excellent facial animations. So
it's a bad one. But I got home like 5 minutes before we started, so hey, this is what we got. Jake?
Yep.
Against my better judgment, against all that I hold holy and dear, I think I'm gonna give you the floor. I am at the same time gonna try and put a video of some Mass Effect in here so we get something a little different. So, all
right.
Forgive me if this breaks a little. Just give me
multiplayer footage.
There's just a comparison of old Emmy and new Emmy.
Yeah. Let me preface this with a couple things. One, I get into this a little bit in an upcoming article that will be released this week at some point, so feel free to check that out on relay.sc. But I kind of get into like the meta of game development a little bit into that, but I'm actually going to talk more specific about the problems I have with this game. So, I'm a very big fan of this. It's easily one of...
Audio. Oh my god. I gotta learn.
Just mute the video.
I know, I forget to when mute I...
the video.
I forget to when I post it. This is the first time I've ever run video. Okay?
Anyway, go ahead.
Go, Jake. Sorry.
Also, this is still not even... Okay. These comparisons are just terrible.
I'm not the one making the comparisons.
Just
someone
put
else does
up gameplay footage. Don't put up these stupid comparisons. Because honestly, the one on the right looks better in this part.
It
looks
yeah, it
better.
Does.
So, I don't know, man.
I know.
Frostbite 3 is a great engine. It makes things look really good. I'm a huge fan of the series to the point where I actually really liked the ending of Mass Effect 3 when everyone else hated it. Especially because I finished Mass Effect 3 after the Leviathan DLC came out, and the Leviathan DLC provided a heck of a lot of context for the ending of that game that was much needed, and it's kind of a bummer, and that's what makes DLC poopy.
Jake,
so,
one thing. Before we get too far in, will there be spoilers in your rant?
Yes.
So, for anyone...
At least minor, like, I'm not going to get specific, but, like...
There might be minor spoilers in this
rant.
If
you want to go into this game completely blind, then...
this is the time to tune out.
Yep.
Oh, all right.
Thanks for watching.
See you later.
Yep.
go.
So I really liked Mass Effect 3. Mass Effect 2 is one of, if not my absolute favorite game of all time. It's a series very near and dear to my heart. It's honestly like an achievement in storytelling, at least to me. Again, everything I say is my opinion. Take it for that. Mass Effect Andromeda is a game that borrows very heavily from the structure of Dragon Age Inquisition. So if you've played Dragon Age Inquisition, Mass Effect is very similar to this. I'm going to start with some good things that I like about this game, because there are a lot of things that I like about this game. One, the environments in this game are magnificent.
Pretty great, yeah. I will agree. I'm just going to say places where I agree or disagree with you, because I have also played it. Go.
Whoever is their environment artist at BioWare, man, you deserve like an award or something. Especially on freaking Volds, the ice planet. Oh, it's beautiful. It's not like a Hoth-like planet. Like, this is actually like a block of ice, this planet, and it's gorgeous. And then by the time you actually repair the terraforming device, like, this beautiful green aurora is like in the sky, and it reflects on all of the ice, and it's just incredible. Like one of the levels is actually like a low gravity destroyed planet that you're going around driving in next to no gravity in your truck, going from like biosphere to biosphere, and it's also just incredibly beautiful. Like, I would put it against Broken Moon in just pure gorgeousness. Also, I think the characters in this game are really well done. Not as well done as Mass Effect, but I mean, I also played Ghost Recon Wildlands immediately before playing Mass Effect Andromeda, and like, it's night and day. these characters are actually really good. Except for you, Liam, you suck. You're the worst. I hope you die. but I think a lot of that stuff is really well done. There's a decent amount of side quests in that game that are actually really good and have their own, like, small stories. And I think that's really good. And it also kind of encourages some exploration, as you can find hidden weapon caches and things and cool loot and stuff. I also really like the crafting system in this game, because if you craft weapons, they're way better than things you would purchase or find in the wild. All of that being said, this game is a mess. This game is the hottest mess. Also, yes, I agree. The Drac is standout character.
It's always the Krogan. It's always the Krogan.
Also, I like him better than both Rex and Grunt. So he's an awesome grizzled old man Krogan who's lived 1,000 years and he hates everyone and everything, and it's awesome. So the first thing that everyone was ranting and raving about with this game is the facial animations. The problem with the facial animations is some of them, they don't cue properly. They're synced correctly, but they're not attached to the right points or something. And they'll make these weird faces in very emotional and tense situations, and it takes you right out of it every time. Along with the human and Asari characters, they had almost no eye animations, and that's actually something that BioWare was known for, really good eye animations, because you can tell like a lot of emotion from the muscles around the eyes, like right here. But every cutscene, all of the humans in Asari were just staring like this the whole time, just looking at you. They may look to the side, but their eyes
don't. My face is tired.
And it was horrible. That being said, the patch that came out about 2 weeks after release fixed a lot of those problems. So take that for what you will. Also, another really good thing about this game is the combat is excellent. Also, the UI and user experience in this game is easily the worst of any game I've ever experienced in my life. The menus are buggy. There's way too many of menus. Like, remember how in the previous Mass Effects you had your journal that logged all your quests?
Yep.
And they weren't really sorted in any fashion, but they had like,
I couldn't figure out what the hell I was supposed to do in Andromeda.
Yeah, so here's the thing. Like, you know how like the quests, like the ones where you kind of really need to know, like, oh, this quest is here, this quest is here. They'll have like the planets or like priority mission before. Like, it wasn't very elegant, but it did its job. And it was clean. This game is like, hey, we didn't really like putting all the quests out in the open like that, so we're going to put them in like 15 sub-menus that have an additional 4 sub-menus in them. We're going to sort them all, and you're never going to be able to find any quests that you want to do. No Man's Sky's user interface is actually probably one of the better parts of that game.
much, much better than Andromeda.
Better than this! And like, it has this infuriating thing where you can't change your weapons, you can't change your armor, you can't change anything without either being on your ship and landing on a planet, going to a fast travel point or right before a critical mission.
I hated that you have to hit escape through everything. Open the map. Yes. Oh, I'm going to escape like 14 times to get back to the freaking game.
Is it? So if you hit M, it goes directly to your map. But instead of when you hit escape, it goes back to the game. It thinks you went into the map from the main menu. So you have to hit escape like 1,000 times to get out of it. Ugh.
Why? Who the hell did that?
And then... yeah, and on the ship. So you can change it on the ship, but if you're out, you have to go to a fast travel point and waste time. I think this is a legacy thing from previous Mass Effects where it was the same way. But the thing about previous Mass Effects is it wasn't an open world game. Each particular story beat and each particular mission was its own separate contained thing. So you change your loadout before every mission, but that made sense because aside from being in those missions, you don't need your weapons. You don't need your armor. You don't need any of that stuff. So it just infuriating. But the biggest thing that I have a problem with in this game is its story. And it's not because it's bad. Because everyone says, oh, it has a bad story. It's not because it's bad. So my problem with the story in this game, and this is where it gets a little spoilery, and I'm going to avoid talking specifics, but this will kind of tell you the overarching themes of this game. So to give context, you're on a colony ship going to Andromeda from Earth. There's a bunch of other colony ships. You're on the human one. There's a Turian one and a Sari one, etc. And you get there, and there's this weird cloud of dark matter that's like ripping through planets, ripping through ships, ripping through all kinds of stuff. Immediately when you get there, there's an alien race that just hates everyone and everything.
And there's another alien race where literally the first time you ever meet any of their entire race, he's like, I like you. I'm joining your crew permanently.
Now, see, here's the thing about Jahl. I think he is one of the better written characters. And the whole reason for and you find out this later, the Ungaran people are very much like that. They're very... like, they wear their heart on their sleeve. Their emotions are out in the open. If they like you, they're going to tell you. It
bothered the hell out of me.
Is it
like Futurama or Hitchhiker's Guide? There was just a race that whenever an invading army came in, they were just like, yep, all right.
Isn't that Doctor Who?
We're slaves to you. All right.
That's no. Who. No, is the
Doctor Who? Ah, thank you.
They fight back against the cat. So that's the whole thing. The leader of the Ket is the big bad dude, and then the whole plot is like you're basically trying to make Andromeda livable. More specifically, the Helios cluster, and then you find like a big conspiracy, there's like grander things. There's this race of alien robots that kind of just exist on the planets, which is the most interesting part of the story, in my opinion. But there's all kinds of things that happen. Like in like the second act of the game that kind of like hints at something grander, hints at like big things happening. It's like, you know, the first two acts of Mass Effect 1 when they don't really talk about the Reapers at all. They're kind of this weird myth, but they're always kind of like,
and then comes in huge and then it just changes everything. And it's a big punch to the face. It's just like, awesome. Oh, they're not a ship. They're this alien freaking race that, yeah.
Andromeda does.
And then you can shoot one to death in Mass Effect 3 with a rocket launcher.
I mean, yes.
So Andromeda does that. It has one big twist on the story in the middle that I actually thought was really cool and kind of made like the Ungaran people like interesting, like really interesting. That's why I like them now, because you're not at that part of the story yet, David.
I'm not. I gave up. I don't care about the game.
Yeah. So that happens, but then like the reasons for it and why this all happened and you kind of discover like maybe the Ket answer to someone else besides the Archon. Maybe there's someone even higher than that. There's like someone pulling the strings. Maybe the Andromeda Initiative mission was actually like a conspiracy. Maybe like there's some bad money and all of that. And then you get to the point where you face up against the big bad dude, you kill him, and the game is over.
Oh my.
All of those story threads aren't even touched. The game just ends.
Is it possible then it's going to be like an Empire Strikes Back scenario?
No.
No?
Like, hey, we're now there's an epilogue. It's like, hey, we're colonizing this weird civilization Dyson sphere-y type thing. That's where the humans are going to live, and that's kind of awesome, and everything is fine, and we're going to go explore forever. Hooray, me and my team, because we're a family now. And the game is over.
Oh my.
That's it.
Yeah.
So, you know what happened there.
So, EA
told them to release the game.
Yes. The story is not bad. It's not done.
None of the game is done. You know when I finally decided to stop playing that freaking game? The ninth time I landed on a planet, I'm like, I'm going to go explore. Oh, here's some random enemies being dropped down in a ship. Oh, they're going to be dropped down right on top of a mound in the earth. Oh, one of them got stuck in the earth and it can shoot at me from that earth and hit me no matter what. And I can't even see it. Great. Okay. Fun. Thanks, game. The amount of bugs in it is unconscionable.
Here's things.
Are there more or less bugs in that than Earth Defense Force?
There is some obvious EA cynicism in chat, and I do want to address a couple things that I don't think is the case. Super Serious says, with the whole missing arcs, it sounds to me they want to keep the story going in DLCs. That is incorrect, as you find all of the arcs by the end of the game. Where's the other comment I wanted to address? I forgot the other one. This game is just not finished. It's the same reason why I stopped pre-ordering games so long ago when I pre-ordered Star Wars The Force Unleashed 2 and realized there's an entire third of that game that is missing. Mm-hmm. They mentioned the Quarian arc. It's just a loose story thread. But at the beginning of the game, they even say like the Quarian arc hasn't even been launched yet. So like it's obvious that wasn't even going to be a part of the story, arc of the story.
That is their explanation on, oh, we didn't include Quarians because their launch didn't arc.
Now, I don't know.
They couldn't find enough stock photos to do a whole cast.
Again, that's like a very cynical thing. Maybe they didn't need the Quarians for the story they wanted to tell. Like, I can't, like, speculating on that is just that. It's speculation.
Are they Geth?
I'm taking what Andromeda is, not for what it could have been, but for what it is in front of me, and that is unfinished. There is at least like another 5 hours of story that is missing from that game where it ties all of those things together. Also Bilek, pledging to Star Citizen is not pre-ordering a game.
It's pledging, not pre-ordering. There is a difference.
Yeah.
It's a very technical one, but I do want to kind of bring this back to Star Citizen a bit as we prepare to round this out. No?
We're not going to talk about Star Citizen in the context of Mass Effect Andromeda because I want people to read my article because that's exactly what it is.
That's a good point. Okay. Can I make a mention of something here?
Do it.
BioWare has a history of this, as I mentioned before. They have the capacity to make very, very good RPGs. Dragon Age Origins.
KOTOR.
Dragon Age Inquisitions. KOTOR. Mass Effect 1 and 2.
And 3.
And 3 I haven't played 3, but I've heard it's
really good.
It's all right.
And by the way, I played it again recently with my wife, and it's wonderful.
By the way, I know you were saying Mass Effect Andromeda is based loosely on Dragon Age Inquisition. Dragon Age Inquisition is a truly great game.
I like it.
However, it had some dated mechanics even when it came out, because it was obviously worked on it for a long time, and I was worried they were going to carry over some of those to Mass Effect Andromeda.
Oh, did they?
The thing is, if Mass Effect Andromeda had fixed some of the bugs and had fixed some of the ridiculous things with it, it would still have the incredibly horrible dialogue writing that it's plagued with. I think that its dialogue is some of the worst I've seen in video games at points, and...
Again, I came into this immediately after Ghost Recon Wildlands.
Okay, that is the worst. So
it's the worst.
Love the game. Horrible.
Big Mix 3.
It's only because you hear it 400 times.
He says it every 5 seconds. And it drives me insane.
Sorry. Go ahead, Nakara.
I just wanted to. You know, it doesn't. It's sad.
It's really sad.
And I don't understand why this keeps happening to BioWare. I don't know if it's an EA thing. I'm not 100% sure about that. But EA does have a history of that. But you look at what they did with Dragon Age Origins and Dragon Age 2. Dragon Age Origins was like well over 100 hours long. Yep. I think I ended up somewhere around like 120 or 140.
Yeah.
It was a very difficult game. Very, very good game. It's a classic. Dragon Age 2 was 30 hours long and it was terrible.
I finished it in 25.
There you go. Terrible game. And they literally said that Dragon Age Inquisition was their sort of penance making up for Dragon Age 2, which was terrible.
Yeah.
I don't understand why they didn't learn their lesson in Mass Effect and go, yeah, maybe we shouldn't do Dragon Age 2 again. You know? Like, it's unfortunate.
Some of the things I've heard, like that they had a $40 million budget for Andromeda.
That's a tiny budget.
If that's true, that is a really, really bloody small budget for a
triple. You shouldn't have made an open world game if you have that budget.
And then hearing that their original prototypes had been procedural, like entire procedural planets.
Amazing.
But on a $40 million budget, no.
No way.
Like, no. I think they got screwed. I think they got screwed by pushing too early. Pushing with unfinished story, unfinished gameplay, untested everything. I think it could have been a great game, but it got pushed too early. And guess what? Guess what hasn't been pushed yet? And guess what I'm glad hasn't been pushed until it's ready?
David.
I don't care.
South Park.
Yes. David, South Park. Literally. No, the Fractured But Whole is being delayed until it's ready.
So... David.
Yeah, Jake?
That's really the entire point of my article.
I know. I'm talking about the fractured butthole. Stop.
The fractured butthole.
I tried to save it for you, Jake.
I'm getting some strange looks every time I say the fractured butthole.
I mean, it's because you're emphasizing in the wrong places.
Oh,
it's because you're saying the fractured butthole, not the fractured butthole.
Can I take a hard right turn?
Or the fractured butthole? The fractured but whole, or the fractured butthole?
Which one cracks it for you?
They both crack me up.
So, can I take a hard...
There's a hole in that argument.
Go for it, Nakara.
Yes. I want to take a hard right-hand turn into something that actually is kind of interest to me. I was a massive fan of Diablo 1 and 2.
Oh. Diablo.
Because it wasn't as good as it should have been, I was not as big a fan of Diablo 3. I have to say, as a dedicated and loving player of the Necromancer class in Diablo 2, I am so excited that the Necromancer is coming to Diablo 3, and that will bring me back into that game.
Probably.
So, bravo to Blizzard. Bravo to Blizzard for actually finding a way to bring me back into Diablo 3.
Oh, I remembered a thing about Andromeda that made me hate the game even more.
Quick, go.
Yeah, go.
is very quick. You know how in the original trilogy, you could command all your squad mates to use their respective abilities, and it made for really awesome strategy. The extent of the control you have over your squad mates is go here or kill this.
You know what I actually found really annoying in Andromeda? The inability, especially in multiplayer, to like they based everything off like combos. Oh, if you combo these two powers, you get a combo explosion.
I love combos.
But you can't do it in multiplayer.
I love them.
Like, there are no classes that allow you to comp. Like, it's all about, you have to work with other people. I don't want to work with other people. Screw other people. I hate other people.
It's a co-op mode.
I hate other people. Yeah, you know what would be great for a co-op mode? If you made a game that was good enough for anyone else I know to buy it. Because you, Jake, are the only other person I know that's bought it. Because nobody else wants it, because it's a shitty, bloody game.
Well, I think this is part of the do not pre-order. Mantra has finally started to seep into people's brains a bit.
I only pre-ordered because I wanted this.
No, I'm not trying to
why
roll in
the
your pre-order.
Why does the Rover look so different?
I think this is Ubisoft's fault, honestly. I think them screwing up their games constantly has led to people actually taking a bit more of a backseat. And once the review scores started to come out, you could tell right away, you're like, 70%? 70%? Really? Like, that's terrible in this day and age.
Yeah. 70% is like a 40. Anyway, we are done talking about Mass Effect. We're done talking about Zelda. We're done talking about literally everything for this month. We will be doing another one of these next month. If you want to find out the date or the time, follow us on Twitter. If you want to be notified right before it goes live, follow us on Twitch. If you want to miss out and maybe watch it later on like YouTube or something, then subscribe to YouTube or just check Relay. It'll all be going up.
Yeah.
Yep.
And
also, if you're especially crazy, sick in the head, just the worst kind of person.
The worst.
You can go to patreon.com/relay_sc and support us there. But, you know.
Pretty sick bunch over there.
You have kind of a terrible person.
Have you guys heard of Discord? We should get one those.
We do have a Discord.
Oh, yeah. If you want to hang out with us and communicate with us directly, the easiest possible way to do that is if you go on Discord, you go to discord.gg/relaysc, because Discord hates underscores. Sorry, underscore. you can hang out with us there. It's kind of a cool little community we've fostered over the years.
Now, just before we go... Evo Lover has sent me a little image of something that he created, and I'm putting it up on screen right now because I think it's great. Because
my goodness,
it's pretty freaking great, and I love it.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so awesome! Thank you.
That's
beautiful.
Absolutely
that's
beautiful.
Incredible.
That's so awesome. Shout out to Evil Lover. Thank you so much for that. That is badass as
Thank
hell.
Thank you all for listening to
Pirate on Mass Effect. I know there's got to be a CIG somewhere. CIG guy somewhere watching this.
Yeah.
Get that in the game.
Yeah.
Get that in the game.
You have nothing to do with spaceships. You literally designed the FPS levels. But this.
That looks beautiful. I think it's fantastic. Thank you so much. Thank you to everyone who came out and listened to us rant about things that are not Star Citizen. Tune in Saturday.
TLDR by Horizon, not Mass Effect.
TLDR by Zelda, not Horizon or Mass Effect.
You should buy
Horizon. Zelda's amazing.
Zelda's amazing.
Also,
Stellaris is too.
Yeah. Yes. Hey, next week, next month, next Beefcast.
Walking through the ship now.
Yeah, we are. I'm bringing us back, but next month, I don't know what else we're going to be talking about, because who knows what's going to happen between now and then, but I can say...
Persona 5 right now.
I can say one of our topics will be VR.
Awesome.
Sure. Hey, by that time, Bridge Crew will have come out.
Bridge Crew is probably going to be another one of our topics.
Oh, I really wish I had VR right now.
Bridge Crew?
I want to play that so bad.
It is very, very likely that whether it's good or bad, Bridge Crew will come out. Yeah. So, come back next month. Probably Bridge Crew. Definitely VR. Who knows what else? We'll see. Sona. Thanks for joining in. Thanks for listening. Thanks for following. Thanks for subscribing. Thanks for existing. Thanks for living. Thanks for doing everything that you do every single day. I think you are all wonderful, wonderful people.
Thanks for showering.
That too. That's very important. We'll see you in the verse.
Goodbye.
See you in the verse.